Happy birthday, dear Zoe. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Zoe. Happy birthday to you again. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Zoe. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Zoe.
To trick her to come up to say she would do the announcement. Amen. Let's stand. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we just come to you in the wonderful and the precious name of Jesus, and we want to thank you, Father God, for this time that we can fellowship with you in spirit and in truth, Lord, even as we heard earlier on. Many countries around the world, Father God, don't have an opportunity for the brethren to dwell and worship together. So we want to thank you for that incredible privilege. We pray your blessing. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power. And we thank you for your anointing this morning. And so we give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That's just not the same. You know, this whole wireless thing, I was talking earlier on. I tried it the other day, wireless bungee jumping, but it's very sore. Because when I went, and I was waiting for the, there was a loud, it was all right, so we know, we got worship practice, hospital ministry still can't do anything, but please, if you can come on a Tuesday night, and we are busy arranging to do a full-on online Bible study that we may be able to convert the Tuesday night to a Bible study that Lionel and Isabel will do for us, loaves and fishes. So if you can bring food or bring money or just bring your time, we want to feed the poor. Prison ministry, as you know, still on hold. Youth and adults has been amazing every Friday. Listen here, every one of you is a youth because you're younger than your mother. So don't come and tell me I'm too old for that. If you are older than your mother, something wrong.
You have fun.
And then beach evangelism, please join us. Thank you. Let's do some praise and worship.
Alright, come on, let's praise and worship, everybody. Get up, clap your hands, let's go. Sing, oh precious.
Sing, oh precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched. Also soul's atoned by the blood of a lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me down. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Say it, oh precious is the flow that makes me white.
darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
I worship you.
God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my who you are. That is 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 who you are.
Thank you.
Amen. Isn't that great? Well done, guys. That was amazing. It was really, really good. Yeah, I don't know how I'm going to qualify to sing with this lot. I'm going to have to do that whole miming thing, lip sync. Yeah. The way around it is to put a shower here, of course. If I've got a shower, I can sing like, psh, the heavens will come down. You know, part of our worship is our giving, and I just want to share something in Proverbs 10, in verse 22. And I want to ask you something. So a few years ago, I was in partnership with somebody that owned a seafood outlet. And we were operating in a predominantly Indian area in Durban. And most of my customers were Muslim, you know, and they would come along and ask me, is this halal? Is this halal? And I actually shared this story with some people the other day. And eventually I thought, you know what? I'm going to get this thing sorted out once and for all. Oh, well, that's good. Thank you, Lord. Talk about the power of prayer. Eh? And so what happened? I eventually went to an organization and organized a certificate that would certify our business halal. And I think it was within a month, the business crashed and shut down. I'm like, God, how could you, after giving me the halal certificate? You know what he said to me? Why would I give you anything that will not be a blessing to you? And I realized that I moved in presumption and assumption instead of really listening to what God has to say and relying on Him. Amen. So that's the moral of the story. When God blesses, it adds no sorrow, but it continues to be a blessing so that you can be a blessing. Amen. Yeah. Now you can bring your money. Wait. No. Who are the mic people? Mic people. Where's Esty? Esty, remember I told you about impact fractures on my little toe? Remember that one? Remember that story? Yeah, we just add to that one. I got a whole set of them now. My toe's just gone another few centimeters shorter. I used to have really long toes before, but you know, walking barefoot has got its disadvantages. Oh dear Lord, where are we going with this one? Are you all done? Father, we just want to bless you for the seed that's been sown. We want to thank you, Father God, that you are a mighty God. Thank you, Lord, that you hear prayers and you hear supplications. Father, I pray back multiplication to every single person, Lord, whether they sow or they don't sow. Because, Lord, your word says that you are a good, good Father. And we bless you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to all the visitors. Hello. Oui. You see. So earlier on, the mic fell on my foot. And then I walk into a mic. I think it's a sign. Hold the mic. Take it away. I'm going to get those steel cap boots. But it'll only be a steel cap on my toes because I don't like wearing shoes, so it's going to be a bit difficult. Yeah. You know, this morning when we were standing outside, I finally saw the little bird that built that nest up on our balcony. Tiny little yellow and green bird with a... What a pretty little bird, and it had a little hoha. Oh, sorry, hoha. No, not a beak, it had an insect in its beak, hoha. Colloquial for insect. Hoha. Say hoha. No. Hoha. Yeah. Got a hoha in my... Help me! Okay. This is going to be chaotic. Eh? I know it. Oh, Lord, what you do? Eh? Yeah. What's that song by the Carpenters? We've only just begun. It's not even funny, Lord. So the other day I was doing some gardening out here, and a leaf fell off a plant, you know. And I think I was singing that song, Sunny 95, and just, no, I didn't. But I mean, now that I think about it, I should have been singing that song. But as the leaf hit the ground, I thought about what the leaf had to say. You know, here's a plant with a leaf on it, and there it goes. And so the thought came to mind, I want to break free. Aren't we all like that little leaf? I'm going to play us a little video clip. Let me just put it out. Don't worry, I will put the lights back on again. But I want us to watch this video clip.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. You're so self-satisfied. I don't need you. I've got to break free.
This preach has been a real challenge to me, because obviously there are many people are saying, oh, how could you use Queen's song in the church? Well, I don't know. I don't know what I was thinking. But it seemed to fit. It took me literally hours to find that little video, you know. And aren't we a little bit like that leaf in the tree? I want to leave now. Or, if you leave me now. You know, you can go to like a million things with this, the title of this thing. But we just like that leaf. We're part of the tree. We're part of community. We're part of the church. We're part of God's kingdom. We're part of everything. But and we're part of family. But somehow, we want to break free. Any of you been like that? I was sharing a story. I didn't quite finish school, you know. I can't tell you what I said to the principal, but anyway, I didn't finish school. And I went back with my mom, and they tried to get me back into the school. And I think the last thing I said to the principal is probably the thing that made it that I wouldn't return to the school. And so I decided to go and work. And I worked in the same company as my dad, and I wanted to buy a guitar. Now, when I was young in South Africa, you could buy something on a type of credit. It wasn't even called credit in those days. It had a different name. But you could, 6 months treated as cash. 6 months treated as cash. Not lay-by. Yeah, but they actually just kept it for you. And then you, yeah. So, yeah. No, but I took the guitar home. Yeah. So I went to my dad and I said, Dad, I want to buy a guitar. And it's the princely sum of 125 rand. It's equivalent to about 250 baht now. We are talking 1975. That was big money. To be able to pay it off in 6 months. Needless to say, it will tell you what I was earning as a salary. So anyhow. So I give, and I'm like all keen. And he goes, no. I said, what do you mean, no? I'm paying for it. No. Said, okay. And then, if this song was existing then, I would have been singing that. I want to break free. I went upstairs. I lived in the attic. Took a blanket, threw it on the floor, put all my clothes in there, just like the movies. Except the hobo's got a little one with a stick. I walked out of there. I've had it with you lot. I need my independence. Any of you recognize that story? Any of you been in a relationship or in a situation or in a work situation and all you want to do is get out and break free? We all want freedom. And you know what amazes me about teenagers? Oh, you know what? I'm sick of you teaching me like a child. You are a child. Yeah, but you know what? I'm 13 years old. I'm 15 years old. And I believe I can make my own decisions. Sure. Please go and find yourself a home. Off you go. And then, you know, so I was too young to sign the lease. And I first stayed in a little residential, and then I got somebody that would sign the lease for me. I was so excited, going my first shopping on my own. Okay. Dishwasher, floor cleaner, window cleaner, general purpose cleaner, washing powder. They didn't have things as softener back in the day. No, that's all modern junk. And it's just going, and get to the till. And you put food, baked beans, very important. Bully beef, very important. You know, like all the essentials for life. And you get to the cashier, and you know. But you're not interested. You're looking at the numbers, and you're thinking about, and you're realizing, it's big trouble. And eventually the bill comes up, and now you've got to decide, do I keep the food or do I keep the cleaning material? So you think, I'm not that stupid. I need to eat. I need to live. So for a couple of weeks, you don't clean the flat. Hey. And you start growing your own penicillin in your bread. And the stuff in your fridge start getting a life of themselves. And stuff starts moving around in the refrigerator. And people come and visit and go, whoa, bro, what's that? Eh? Hey, you know, I'm a bachelor. I got my independence. I'm free. Good luck with that, Zoe, because that's not in the bed. Anyhow, so I do that. And what do we realize? Suddenly, we've been sheltered by our parents. They've been taking care of us. But we've wanted this freedom. We want to get out. Which brings us the story of our favorite guy that you all know. And I'm going to read to it in 15. Luke 15, 11 to 13a. Then he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me my portion of good that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country. I'm out of here. I'm done. Sick and tired of shoveling soil. I know what you're thinking. You notice I carefully chose my words. Soil. Picking up bales of hay, feeding the cows and feeding and doing. I'm sick of it. I'm sick and tired of waking up late every morning with my breakfast served to me and all my washing done. I'm sick and tired of you paying for my school fees and for my clothing and taking. I'm just sick of it. I'm out of here. And the problem is, why did he want to get out of there? Because he didn't know the difference between entitlement and inheritance. Give me what's due to me. How many times do we say to God, why don't you just give me what's mine? I name and I claim. I decree. I demand. That's how we pray. Lord, you owe me. But you see, if we understand the difference between entitlement and inheritance, we'd realize that when we inherit something, we get something that we never worked for, we didn't pay for, and we didn't deserve. So I have a question. Why have we walked away? Why have we broken away? Why have we broken free? You know, there are many marriages that come to an end because one of the spouses decides, I'm out of here. I can't do this anymore. I need to be free. I need to start again. I just don't love you the same anymore. You know that thing? Yes, it happens. Or somebody's been working for years in a company and they're just about in line for promotion. And it's, I'm out of here. Oh, so where are you going? No, I'm going to go where people are going to appreciate me and my hard work. You know that one? Yeah. You know, I get to work early. I don't take smoke breaks or tea breaks, and I work hard. And what do I get? Nothing. Meantime, there's a big fat bonus and a promotion waiting for you. What happens? You prematurely leave. And then you go to another company, and they don't know you. And so you come in from the bottom. You know that awkward feeling when you... they want to introduce you now to the rest of the staff. And, so who are you? No, my name's Russell, you know. At the other company, I was this. They say, cool. See you around, eh? Because now from this that I wanted to break free from, I'm going to go to this. And then eventually I'm upset about that and I don't want to work there anymore. You see, the problem is not where we work, and the problem is here. We want our freedom. So what type of freedoms do we want? Freedom of association. But there's a warning. Listen to this. Mixing with the wrong crowd. 1 Corinthians 15:33. Don't be deceived. Bad company corrupts good character. We want freedom of belief. Wrong thinking and wrong teaching. 1 Timothy. Now, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times, some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons. You see, we constantly want to be free. Please give this lady a translator. Yeah? There you go. Sorry, dear. We get you one. There we go. Oh, we'll wait. It's family. No, the Mark's wife. There you guys see. Pleasure, dear. I just don't know how I'm going to repeat the last lot that I said because I don't remember. Please excuse me. And I'm not even joking. We want freedom of speech. We want to be able to say what I want when I want it. Isn't that weird? Oh, you shouldn't have said that. Oh, I am who I am and that's it. Take it or lump it. We want to be able to dress like we do, tattoo like we do, act like we do, scream like we do, because you know what? I have liberty in Jesus. And then we get that old Jesus. God has set me free. Don't be judging me. Don't condemn me. Okay. I'm free in Christ. What are you doing with your liberty? The Bible says this. In 1 Corinthians 6:12a, everything is permissible for me, but not all things are beneficial. What are we doing that seems to be permissible, but it benefits nobody? Is that okay? No, it's not okay. Freedom of the press. It's so funny, eh? But now we call it social media. You go as a Christian and you make a statement on social media. Good luck with that. Oh, you bigot. Oh, you know, you're so judgmental. Now you notice the person criticizing you that you have the right to be able to speak about your beliefs and about what you think about. And they bring you under oppression and say, how dare you? I'm talking to you, and you. Yeah, you can look at me, I'm talking to you. You're the ones that criticize the whole time. See what you have to say now. Freedom to choose our state of life. Listen, it's my body. It's my body. I will do what I want to. If I want to murder my unborn child, I'm going to. See. If I want to be a prostitute, I will do it. See. It's my body. Don't tell me what I have to do. Freedom of religion. Exodus 20, 2 to 3. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. Now you can go look that up in any language that you like. It says, no other gods. We want freedom from bondage and slavery. Romans 6:12 to 13. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. But present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as being instruments of righteousness to God. What are we using our bodies for? What are we using our voices for? What are we using our talents for? What are we using our gifts for? Is it for sin or is it for righteousness? So how does true freedom come? True freedom comes from three fundamental things: humility, submission, and obedience. I shared it with somebody the other day. Let's say you're a football player, American football. That makes it easy. And you're this amazing player, but for some reason, you can't be in that city anymore and you get sent to one of these really small... Well, come in. Come. Make yourself comfortable. Just do it. Do it. As you know, your shirt says, just do it. Sorry. Please. You speak English? Oh, good. Okay. And you're this amazing player. And you join the local club. And the one guy's got a physique like mine. And the other guy has got muscles like me. And there's a skinny guy and a fat guy and a guy with, well, you're not sure when you talk to him, you're not sure which eye to look at. So, you know, and he's, what do you call it, the receiver, hey. So he's running. And he sees two balls. He has to decide which one to catch. Can you see? You want the light on? You know, it's one of those teams. And of course, you, this massive guy, physique, a million points, everybody's been baying for your talents, and you walk into the club, and there's the coach. It's only his second year at running the team. Never coached before. How's it? Hi, yeah. Firstly, I need to tell you who I am. My name is Russell Watson. I'm probably the greatest gift to American football that has ever walked on this planet. I need you to understand, I don't drink normal water. I want only red M&Ms and blah, 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 blah. And we go through this massive list and the guy's there with his whistle and the kids all are. You see, he's come into something, but there is no humility. You want to come into something, come in with a humble heart. Jesus was humble. Next minute, he's calling the coach over and he's telling the coach, this so-called captain of yours, he needs to be put in his place. And the coach gently calls him over and says, Russell, actually, he's the captain. He's the guy, since we started, that arrived at every practice. Yes, he doesn't run very well. He can't catch a ball. There's many things he can't do. But every week, he's come in, he's been part of the team, and he's my choice. Oh, well, then I don't know about this. All right, guys, remember, looking forward to seeing you next week. Practice is at 3 a.m. or 3, no, that's a bit early. 3 p.m. on Saturday. No, we'll be playing on Saturday. On Wednesday afternoon, after college, after school, after whatever. I'm not going to practice. Practice. You must see this guy can't even run. Oh, and please, no drinking, no smoking, no taking drugs, no sleeping around. No. I'm not a band, it's just a bunch of rules. I'm out of here. And yet we look at Jesus, James 4:10. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord and he will lift you up. James 4:7. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. 1 Samuel 15:22. So Samuel said, has the Lord as great a delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. You see, we detest humility. It's a sign of weakness. I'm strong. I can handle myself. And I'm not going to obey all these stupid rules. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. And why should I obey the law? Why should I listen to what God has to say to me? You see, all of those three things are bound together by love. Do we love God? Do we love our neighbor? And do we love ourselves? That is the question that we have to ask. What are we doing with our freedom? What have we done since we came out of the bondage of substance abuse and bad relationships and financial dwang and all manner of things? What have we done with that liberty? What have we done when we broke free? What have we done when Jesus went to the cross and died for you and I, where he took suffering and everything upon himself? What have we done with that liberty? John 8:36 says this, "Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed." You know what the amazing thing is? You speak to many, many Christians, and you look at them, and you look at their lives, and you look at the fruit in their lives, and you see there's no freedom whatsoever. How's that possible? Have we failed to understand what God's been saying to us? Have we failed to understand what Jesus did on the cross for us? Have we failed to understand that the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is with us, and he will guide us, and he will protect us, and he will equip us, and he will enable us to do all that we've been called to do? Or do we remain bound in everything? Hey, see you on Sunday. Hey, oh, praise the Lord. Hey, bless you. Hey, huh? Rather just tell the person straight, I'm not coming. We give answers to people that they want to hear, so that we don't need to deal with the things that we have in here. See? Hey, will you please pray for me? Oh, bless you. I'll pray for you, eh? God bless you. But we're on to the next thing already, the next big thing. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. You see on the slide what it says, no longer a slave to sin. Can we honestly say that? Can we honestly say that men walking down the road, and let me tell you, that's one thing about where we live. I've never seen such short shorts in my life. No, seriously, and short dresses. And tops that may as well not be a top. Be like a hanky. And then the men, all like... And you notice when he drinks his coffee, it's like... I'd be scared to do that, because every time I do it, it's like... Punk. My muscle drops to the bottom. And then I have to like... What are we doing? What are we doing with our liberty? Are we running around like lunatics during the week, and then we make sure that we're holy? I met with a man the other night, and my wife was ministering to him, and he had a question. And the question was, so what about karma? So I tried my best, and I thought about scales. Now, can you imagine living a life where you have scales? The good scale and the bad scale. So that means I have to constantly compute in my brain, where am I between good and evil? If I feel that, oh, this wasn't a good week at all. I get a couple of bags of food, I find some poor people. But then what I do is I throw in an extra bag. Put one in the bank for later. See, where are we? And I think what he was really talking about was, whatever you sow, you shall reap. What have we sown and what are we reaping? What is the fruit in our life? What is being produced now as a result of decisions that we made because we wanted to break free? Because we wanted freedom. Freedom from the law. Oh, I'm not bound by the law. I've been made righteous by Jesus Christ and the blood of the Lamb. So I will do as I see fit. You got that, God? If you look back over there, there's a thing with two pieces of glass in it. It's supposed to be sound booth. And it's a little story about shortcuts and obedience. So I bought the thing, and the correct thing to do is to glue it on the inside, then glue the soundproofing, and then you stick it. Nah, that's stupid. Take too long. So I bought this really, really good double-sided tape. And I put it there. And I thought, you know what I'll do? I'll put in a couple of extra pieces as a double insurance against my stupidity. It's great. Put it in. Yeah, and then we sit here during prayer meeting. I just watch. Dung. No. So I go back. And I put it all back. And I take wood. Because earlier on, did you see me with the tray and a piece of wood? That was actually to hold the sponge in place, you know, and force it. Because if I can force the thing, it'll eventually be right. You know, I can keep doing wrong, but as long as I keep forcing it, I'll be right. And the stupid thing fell down again. And I almost had a sense of God sitting and going, are you done? Take it all off. Now, I don't know if you tried to remove double-sided tape. Amen. A lot of it. Man, it is the ugliest job on the planet. And the more you try and pull it off, it snaps off. So you got to snap, 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 snap. Now, I have to go to the hardware store. I have to go buy glue. I have to clean all that off. I have to put the glue on the wood and the glue on the sponge and then stick it. Whereas if I'd just done the right thing in the beginning, you see, I had the liberty to choose to do the right thing or the wrong thing. Instead, I chose the stupid thing. Double-sided. So now what? 1 Corinthians 6:12 says this in the Amplified Version. Everything is permissible for me, but not all things are beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be enslaved by anything and brought under its power, allowing it to control me. You see, I've been offered to make some very quick money. Did you know that?
Oh, I thought, yes.
And this person says, no, it's very easy. And you know, it's a little bit of risk, but it's fine. You take your money, you put it into this thing, and you know, if you can just wait a few days, and then you can take your money out, and then you make more money again. And this guy's making so much. I said, no. He says, no, man. He says, let me tell you a story about a priest who was going over the waterfall. And as he was going over the waterfall, a log came along. And the guy said, quick, grab the log. And he said, no, God will save me. And then he was there, you know, like, and then somebody in a boat came along, quick, jump in. He goes, no, God will save me. And eventually a helicopter came along and they were lowering the ladder. And they said, quick, grab it. And they got near the waterfall. And he said, no, God will save me. You know, he gets to heaven very upset. And then the guy goes to God and says, hey, there's a guy here very upset. Okay, send him in. You know, I thought you were going to save me. He said, listen, I sent you a log, I sent you a boat, and I sent you a helicopter. So the man tells me that story so that I will go into the Ponzi scheme. I said, no, I'm going to trust God for everything. You see, something can appear to be so beneficial. Something can be so permissible. But what will the fruit thereof be? Are we trusting God? Are we going to trust in another scheme and another shortcut? Easy to love God, our neighbor, and ourselves. Are we ready to serve, or we're constantly wanting to be served, constantly looking for affirmation, constantly looking, oh, Russ, well done, eh? Look at you, eh? Oh, you know, God, we really blessed that you're the pastor here. You know, you're such an amazing guy. Oh, rubbish, man. Get over it. Get over it. We need to get over ourselves, and we need to trust God. Amen. Please stand. Yes, Lord, if we are just like that leaf and we want him to break free, now what? What are we going to do with it? What are we going to do with our freedom? Thank you, Lord, for the liberty that comes from being set free from death and sin. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom to be able to make choice. Thank you, Father God, that even as Elijah said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If Baal be God, worship him. But if God is God, then worship him. Father, that we, though we may stand in a on a crossroad, Father God, let us make a decision that is led by you, that is encouraged by you. Father, I just bless you for every single person. I thank you, Father God, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that besides all the nonsense, Father, that your word will remain and that it will produce much fruit. And we give you praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please join us. We're going to break bread and then we're going to have lunch. Lunch.